a covenant that you have to be respectful. I'm just going to be super rude. And then, you know, you guys have to be respectful, so whatever, I'm good. So thank you for inviting me to talk about my book, The Goliath, 100-Year War Between Monopoly Power and Democracy. So I'm going to talk about monopoly and impeachment. Right. So I figured it's kind of timely since Donald Trump is being impeached right now or quasi-impeached or something. So this is typically in America. I took a couple of years to write a book to figure out what happened, my career is sort of defined by the financial crisis, so I wanted to understand why we made the decisions that we did that led to the world that we have. And part of that meant going back to the 1920s and 1930s when the last big financial crisis happened. And it turns out there was an impeachment there. So what I learned, and there were various other impeachments, typically in America when Congress impeaches someone or tries to impeach someone important, it is usually a sign that something has gone wrong in our institutional framework. I know that'll be a shocker to you, but there we go. I don't think we need an impeachment to know that something has gone wrong, but we're getting that signal anyway. So I'll talk about something that we see a lot in the presidential campaigns right now, which is crisis of capitalism, right? So there's a lot of people that talk about, oh, capitalism, socialism, whatever. If you look around the economy today, what you'll really see is a crisis of monopoly. So you have basically one search engine, Google. You have one social network, you have multiple social networks, so they're basically owned by Facebook, at least from the advertising side. We know that, you know, when you try to take an airline or buy a cable service, you usually have very few options. And those are the big markets where you experience. But then there are lots of little markets. And this was not true 20 years ago. But today, concentration is a feature in every market that you go into. So everything from washer and dryers to peanut butter to coffins to beer to missiles and munitions. Concentrated. Small group of corporations or one corporation that controls that market. Now, what does this mean? Well, it means that in effect, in every place that Americans trade with each other, the terms and conditions, the way that we live our lives are set by those people who control those specific markets. So in social networking, you know, Mark Zuckerberg testified to Congress a couple weeks ago. And when he was testifying, saying, here's what we do with Facebook, here's how we operate, I did not see a business leader talking to a bunch of members of Congress who are elected. I saw a guy who runs the global, he's the global privacy czar. He's the global social networking regulator. Like, he runs things. And I saw Congress that was frustrated that they couldn't hold him accountable because he was doing governing work. He's actually said this. So Mark Zuckerberg has said Facebook in many ways is more like a government than a business. We are really setting policies. So a couple of days ago, or actually I think it was today, there was a story that came out that Mark Zuckerberg turns out was having a secret dinner with Peter Thiel and Donald Trump. This kind of gets Democrats all freaked out. But that is sort of the fusion. It's a very scary fusion of big business, and concentrated political power. Now the concentration problem really started in the 70s. This is something I go over in my book. But it is now so extreme that it is disillusioning people and corrupting our politics in really profound ways. Now the bad news is that our institutions are really that broken. They really are that bad. It was not always the case that we would saddle young people with massive amounts of student debt that you'd be paying off forever. Usually we used to think, hey, education is just a good thing for citizens. The institutions are so broken that we've decided that that's a bad idea. The good news though is that we have been here before, a very concentrated and corrupted economy, and we have a choice before us. And there are many ways that this choice reflects itself, but the impeachment is one of those ways. It is a choice. But it's not a choice between whether to impeach Trump or not. Trump is being impeached for a number of reasons. There's a narrow argument he did a bunch of bad stuff, used the presidency in ways that were coercive, that he was arranging with foreign leaders in dangerous ways. There's also a philosophical belief that he's not a legitimate elected president. He doesn't represent continuity with traditional American political norms. Not isolated to just the charges that we're seeing over Ukraine or various other things, but, you know, say he accepted illegal help from Russia. They say that he used, that he went after AT&T, Time Warner, a merger because he was mad at CNN. Stuff that just presidents don't normally do. That's part of an argument that he's just not legitimate. Well, so on the other side, there's a belief that if Trump has done corrupt things, it's no different than any other office holder. So Hunter Biden is the kind of a guy who's in the news, son of Joe Biden, you know. He had no business being on the board of a company controlled by a Ukrainian oligarch and getting $50,000 a month just because of his father's political power. Bill Clinton accepts millions of dollars of speaking fees from powerful actors. So on and so forth. Trump's final ad in 2016, you saw visuals portraying Barack Obama in league with Goldman Sachs. It's just kind of a sense, well, yeah, maybe Trump's a bad guy, but it's not any different than what anyone else has done. Now, I don't want to get into who's right about these specific claims. I have views, but that's because I want to talk about the larger question that we have to answer, and your generation is going to have to clean up the mess. And I'm going to tell you what the mess is that you guys are going to have to clean up. It's going to be a fun cleanup, but it's a lot of mess. So the question isn't really whether Trump did what he did, but why someone like him is in a position in the first place. Or maybe to broaden it out, it's why have we been unable to confront social problems through our democracy? Lifespans are going down, right? We have a catastrophic opioid crisis. It started on Obama's watch and it's continued on Trump's. There's crises everywhere you look. We have one major maker of airplanes, civilian aircraft, it's Boeing. Turns out they can't make airplanes anymore. That's crazy, that's a crisis. And you can see this everywhere, climate change, big crisis. So the question is this an impeachment of a single man or is this an impeachment of a whole way of running society? Now our answer to that question, and I say our answer because I kind of want to move responsibility onto other people, you guys. It's really just laziness. No, I'm just kidding. We are a society, and it is our society, and that determines the path forward. It's also not a partisan question. So Trump, remember, defeated all the Republicans first, and then he defeated Clinton, and a lot of Republicans at an elite level, they think Trump is illegitimate. They are quietly having the same debates as Democrats are, and it's actually a global debate because the same trends you see here are happening everywhere. Now, there are different and mutually inconsistent theories about this crisis. So Joe Biden, most prominent guy saying this, he says Trump is an anomaly. He does not represent the soul of America. All we have to do is go back before this unique and terrifying presence. Trump is the crisis. So this path leads you to just put a Democrat in office and that's it. But from the other side, Trump supporters, they have the same attitude and their attitude is that, is this theory an inverse? Like Trump is just fixing things. Keep Trump in office. He's fixing things, leave it at that. And that's the same basic attitude. The other side of the argument is Trump is a symptom of a crisis that already existed. Lawlessness and rancid inequality projected someone like Trump into office. And so to deal with that problem, we have to radically reorient our institutions. Now, if you believe that there are deep structural inequities that caused Trump, then what's the path forward? So I'm gonna lay out a historical analogy, an impeachment that I wrote about in Goliath. And one of the nice things about historical analogies is that, you know, I don't actually have to have an answer. I could just tell you what happened. I don't know the answer. Again, you guys, it's the best. You guys are gonna have to clean up. So the last impeachment was Bill Clinton in 1998, but that happened in a time of prosperity. And then before that, there was the Richard Nixon. He wasn't impeached, but it's sort of similar. And that happened in a different economy. It was very heavily regulated. It was a pretty stable financial system and economy. Not like ours. Now, the analogy that I'm going to use is about a little known but great impeachment saga, not of a president, but of a Treasury secretary. A guy named Andrew Mellon, who ran Treasury from 1921 to 1932. How many of you have heard of Andrew Mellon? Oh, you have, okay. So how many of you have heard of Carnegie Mellon? Okay, same melon, right? There we go. Yeah. That wasn't a funny Man, I thought these were funny jokes, and like you're kind of laughing, and I don't really care because I think they're funny, but like that was just a comment. It really is the same, like it's Carnegie Mellon. Okay, so he ran Treasury largely the 1920s. I'm going to take you back to the 1920s because there are some similar dynamics to today. So it was a technologically fantastic decade. Radio went nationwide, as did cars, consumer cultures, chemicals, a whole bunch of things that were developed in that decade that were really important. But more importantly, in 1920, Americans were coming out of 20 years of hope, attempts to wrestle with the emergence of this giant new force called the corporation. Right? Corporations formed in the late 1890s to the early the big merger wave, 1894 to 1905, that basically created modern America, modern American corporate giants like General Electric, and that was relatively new. From Teddy Roosevelt, the sort of the rough rider, like a reformer, taking the presidency in 1901, there was a big breakup of Standard Oil, the biggest company that had ever existed in 1911. The income tax, the Senate, direct election of senators, both constitutional amendments that passed. All the way through Woodrow Wilson and World War I, it was reform and idealism. So Wilson created the Federal Trade Commission to tame monopolies, right? The Federal Reserve to tame Wall Street. He broke up AT&T. We've broken up AT&T three times in this, in 1956, 1913, and then 1984. We keep doing it. It's a good thing to break up AT&T. He also broke up the New Haven Railroad, which was not quite a perfect analogy, but it was sort of like the Uber of its day. And he finally started actually taking on plutocrats. And to give you a sense, William Rockefeller, who's the brother of John D. Rockefeller, Woodrow Wilson was about to send him to jail. He was on the board of the New Haven Railroad. And then 2 weeks later, World War I broke out. And World War I changed everything. Just to give you one quick snippet, when World War I broke out in Europe, the stock market here shut down for 6 months. This is a huge deal. Just unimaginably big deal. Woodrow Wilson took America into World War I, and he took his crusade for reform, which he called the New Freedom, he took it global. He said, I'm not only going to get rid of the domestic aristocrats and kings that we have in the form of robber barons running these giant corporations, manipulating the people, the farmer, the worker. But I'm going to actually get rid of the actual aristocrats and kings in Europe that led us to this monstrous war. But Wilson's era ended in catastrophe. And that brought America the 1920s. So from 1919 to 1921, which was the very end of Wilson's administration, he lay basically on his deathbed in his stroke, and there was a massive financial crisis. During the war and immediate post-war era, first America experienced, according to the Federal Reserve, the greatest expansion of business ever known, what the central bank called a period of intense business activity, expansion, speculation, and extravagance, the likes of which has never before been seen in this country or in the world. It was crazy. So the Fed tried to slow it down. So said a Treasury official, if a panic in New York should break out, he would be glad of it. And they did. They raised interest rates, and the economy cracked. In May 1920, commodity prices across the board dropped spectacularly. General prices fell at the fastest rate ever measured. Now, that may seem technical, but if you're a farmer, that's your income. You sell commodities. Okay? You grow cotton. You sell cotton, right? Unemployment went from 4% in 1920 to 12% in 1921. That's a crazy tripling of the number of unemployed in a very short amount of time. Industrial production dropped by a quarter, and over 500 banks failed. Now, the Fed had tried to slow the economy, but the banks, the whole financial system was unregulated, so it turned into a really gruesome crash. Does that sound familiar? Because it should. Because it is exactly what happened during the financial crisis of 2008, 9, and 10. So cotton prices, which I talked about before, dropped by 93%. There were a lot of cotton farmers in this country at the time, so it savaged the farm bill. You got to turn in the farm. A lot like the foreclosure crisis that we saw. The Republicans used this episode they called the crime of 1920 to bludgeon the Democrats in the 1920 elections. It's another analogy to 2016. Rural America swung very far to the right. The war and the failed hope of reform turned a brutal financial crisis. It was a brutal financial crisis and an agrarian depression, and it induced tremendous cynicism. Faith in democracy itself collapsed. So there's this guy named Hiram Johnson, who was a leading progressive at the time. He said, "The people are docile and they will not recover from being so for many years." In 1922, Walter Lippmann was a very important writer. He noted, he wrote two books saying that democracy was kind of unworkable. People are too easily manipulated. There were progressives, corporate progressives, a guy named Herbert Croly, who founded the New Republic, a very important thinker and advisor, kind of one of the creators of the modern Democratic Party somewhat. But he actually argued in the New Republic, and this guy's on the left. I'm on the left too, but not this left. He said, "The fascist route has its significant and even promising aspects," talking about Mussolini. "Substituting movement for stagnation, purposeful behavior for drifting, and visions of a great future for collective pettiness, over collective pettiness and discouragement." Right? That's crazy. 1928, a U.S. Army training manual even concluded that democracy resulted in demagogism, license, agitation, discontent, anarchy. Right? It's a lot of words. They like to overwrought language. So an editorial in the Christian Century stated, "The hope of democracy will revive when it learns how to do the things that need to be done as efficiently as autocracy does them." This is very similar to what we hear today in regards to China. They can govern, they can build trains, and we cannot. It was also a fantastically racist decade. "The dregs of Europe and elsewhere," said one politician at the time, "had orientalized, Europeanized, Africanized, and mongrelized America." Speeches like this were common. The agrarian depression led to the rise of the second Ku Klux Klan, which was, by the way, if you want to know how it worked, it was a for-profit multi-level marketing scheme that sold robes. It's like a for-profit hatred. It's true, it's great. It's very American. So to give you a sense of how powerful the Klan was, they had 4 million members in the early 20s, including the mayor of Portland, Oregon, and the mayor of Portland, Maine. See it as a shining sea. So, Texas, Alabama, and Indiana sent Klansmen to the Senate. And it's time, it's when white mobs burned down Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I think that was in 1919. What was happening is democracy had failed to deliver, so people resorted to ethno-tribalism with symptoms of despair unaddressed by a callous government. Now, even though Republicans were in charge, and this may sound familiar or not, the Democrats were quite pathetic. They nominated J.P. Morgan's lawyer as a presidential nominee in 1924. This had been the party against Wall Street. This is who they're nominating. They fought over social issues like prohibition. The main issue in the 1924 Democratic Convention was the KKK. Would the Democrats condemn it or not? By a very narrow margin, they chose to not condemn the KKK. It's like a victory for the KKK. Democrats supported debt forgiveness deals with European states that privileged Mussolini's government over those of democracies. This is something Mellon was putting together, and the Democrats supported him. And the irony is, this is really weird, and this just gets you a sense that history is weird. The only group, I read this article in the New York Times, and they were like, the only group that doesn't like Mussolini seems to be the KKK, who argue that he's a dictator. It was really weird to read that. Because like 85 wrongs don't make a right. It's just like, anyway. So autocracies, so one of the things to know is that at this time, very similar today, autocracy was rising globally. So you had dictatorships emerging in Portugal, Spain, Italy, Greece, Turkey, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Belgium. Hitler had a beer hall push, right? This is sort of a really scary time. It's actually somewhat similar to what we're seeing today, led by China, in some ways by Russia. And like Facebook today, big business then worked with Republicans to maintain power and dominance. So the Federal Trade Commission, which was created a decade earlier for fair trade to police monopolies, it was run by a man who proudly announced it would no longer serve as a, quote, publicity bureau to spread socialist propaganda. It was a vicious anti-labor decade. So Mellon's younger brother, his name was Richard, He was asked by a senator in 1928 if he could, you know, could you manage a coal mine without machine guns? And he said no. And then he was like, I didn't mean that, but like he let it out, right? It's true. The miners at the time, a lot of them were brought in from Eastern Europe. They basically kept bringing in people who couldn't speak the language of the last group of immigrants they brought in, so they couldn't unionize. And when they finally got to people from Russia, they would say the coal and iron police who were hired by the mine owners, they called them Cossacks, because they were like, that's exactly what the Tsar used to do. This is what it was like in the mines. So now all of this brings me to Andrew Mellon. So who was he? Why was he impeached? So Andrew Mellon was kind of a cross between Warren Buffett, the second richest man today, a third, and Alan Greenspan, was one of those powerful Federal Reserve officials in the last probably 30, 40 years. So here's one profile. Perhaps no other man in big business in this country or any country has been the executive of or the director in so many industrial or financial institutions as Andrew W. Mellon. When he accepted the Treasury portfolio, he resigned from more than 200 directorates in great corporations. Mellon was an oligarch, but he was not particularly well known because he did not engage in public relations. Where did he make his money? The public loves to read of men labeled as industrial king. Carnegie, the steel king. Guggenheim, the smelter king. Rockefeller, the oil king. Ford, the motor king. This would be today like the Jeff Bezos and this is the same type of people. It would be difficult to designate Andrew W. Mellon as king of any one commodity because he is king of so many. He is a king in oil, coal, iron, steel, aluminum, paint, shipbuilding, real estate, and banking, to mention some of the major items. So Mellon was basically today what we would call a private equity baron, except he was also the Secretary of the Treasury, which meant he, at the time, ran the equivalent of the IRS, and he was the de facto chair of the Federal Reserve. Like, so super powerful. He was also a critical part of the Republican coalition. So his best friend, Henry Clay Frick, he and his best friend, they personally financed the campaign against Wilson and the League of Nations in 1919-1920. Warren Harding appointed him Treasury Secretary, and he was like, Mellon's just great with money. The real reason Mellon got the job was that his bank, the Mellon Bank, had lent $1.5 million to Harding's campaign in 1920. Mellon had become bored being a tycoon, and as one of his enemies put it, Mellon needed a change and the grand old party needed the cash. Franklin Delano Roosevelt in the 1920s joked, Calvin Coolidge would like to have God on his side, but he must have Andrew Mellon. These are old-timey jokes. So Mellon was Treasury Secretary under Harding, Coolidge, and Hoover, or as the joke went, three presidents served under Mellon. Now, there's a number of things that he did in office that were obviously corrupt. He ran his businesses straight up from the Treasury. He used influence to get the Federal Trade Commission to stop its investigation of Alcoa, which he owned, and which had a monopoly over the production of aluminum. He passed tax cuts for the rich, including himself, and he used his control over the IRS to give himself the largest tax rebate to reward his friends and punish his enemies. Sometimes the stuff he did was really petty. So the Treasury Department, weirdly enough, had a magazine for architects. I don't know why, but they did. And it began encouraging the use of aluminum in government buildings. Right? Really weird. If you go to the FTC today, which was built sort of around that time, there's a lot of aluminum fixtures. So Mellon employed, this is just to give you a sense of like some of the petty things he did. He employed a former Bureau of Revenue employee as a tax attorney, this guy named D.D. Shepard. And Mellon requested a memo from the Bureau on tax avoidance by the wealthy. He was like, we need to crack down on tax avoidance by the wealthy. So the commissioner got this memo from this guy Shepard, who wrote it. And Mellon was like, who's a bright young Bureau official who can help me with my income taxes? And he's like, this guy Shepard. And then Mellon like got the memo, and rather than using it to say, oh, these are the loopholes the rich use to crack, you know, we should close these, he just used those loopholes. And he hired Shepard, and Shepard was like one of his employees, not a Treasury employee anymore, but he still had an office in the Treasury that just like connected to Mellon's office, right? So this is like a real, like the just like a grifter, right? He also used his office to get companies, his own companies, lucrative concessions from both government contracts and by extorting or manipulating foreign governments. The president of Colombia. Does this sort of ring any bells? Like, that's kind of what's happening today. It's what's been happening for quite some time. So the most important thing that Mellon did, though, was he refused to act in the face of the great banking collapse from 1929 to 1933, which was the Great Depression. And that was caused by a series of policies that encouraged the concentration of wealth and power, everything from pro-merger rules at the FTC and in the courts, to tax on organized labor, to an unregulated banking system prone to speculation, corruption, and gambling with other people's money. In 1932, there was a massive march of World War I veterans who wanted to get paid their pensions from the war a little early because they were poor. And they thought, and the leaders of this movement thought accurately, that if there were more money circulating in the economy, that that would create more economic growth. So this became known as the Bonus March. Mellon was their main opponent. He thought, he was focused on making sure the government didn't run a budget deficit. And if there were extra money, it should go to tax cuts for the wealthy. Because the wealthy were the ones who made things happen. Okay, so what happened? Why did he get impeached? So on January 6, 1932, there was a former cotton tenant farmer named Wright Patman. And Patman had put forward the bonus bill that inspired the bonus army. And he got up on the floor of the House of Representatives. On my own responsibility as a member of this House, I impeach Andrew W. Mellon, Secretary of the Treasury of the United States, for high crimes and misdemeanors. Now, he had been threatening to impeach Mellon for some time, but few believed him, and everyone was afraid of Mellon. Basically, nothing that he introduced was new. It had all been known in the 1920s, but people were afraid. Patman spoke for an hour. He laid out in crisp terms that revealed that his training and experience as a county prosecutor in Texarkana. People broke into Patman's office, and they rifled through his things. Newspapers mocked him nationwide, but it didn't matter. Patman just went ahead anyway. And a week later, he presented his case to the Judiciary Committee and said, kind of embarrassed Mellon's fancy lawyers. And shortly thereafter, Hoover fired Mellon. And rather, he sent him to be the ambassador to England, which everyone knew was firing or demotion. One voter wrote to Patman, "England is too close. Get him sent to China." He was really hated. But the impeachment was not the end. It was the beginning. Hoover did not relent on the bonus bill, and the old order, that which enabled a man like Mellon to build his wealth and power, remained in force. So what else did populists like Patman do? Well, after the impeachment, there was a bitter fight within the Democratic Party that is somewhat similar to the arguments that you might see going on now. Democrats knew in the face of this collapse there was an amazing opportunity, but they disagreed on how to deal with it. So one faction of the party was led by a social reformer named Al Smith, who was financed by the DuPonts. They were another giant financial kind of oligarch family. Smith believed that this was the chance for the Democrats to become the party of big business and seize that mantle from the GOP. Now we can get the big donations. We can be the natural party of government and work with big business. And to do this, he thought the Democrats should ignore the economy and run on prohibition, which was the social question of its day. His main opponent was Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And Roosevelt was encouraging the Democrats to run as the party against the, quote, malefactors of great wealth, run on the economy, to make prohibition a sort of a sideshow. Roosevelt and his allies, which were people like Patman, a guy named Cordell Hull, Tennessee, a bunch of others, mostly in the West and the South, they understood that fascism was rising. This is when Hitler was gaining his power. And fascism was in part the result of financial concentration. And unlike the mass movements of fascists abroad, the American people had not turned to violence in the wake of mass poverty, he noted. But to fail to act is, he said, not only to betray their hopes, but to misunderstand their patience. Roosevelt won, and Hoover lost in part because he had the bonus army. These protesters, it was a lot like Occupy Wall Street. They were camped out in D.C. He had them tear gassed, and that was very unpopular. They actually accidentally tear gassed a couple senators too at the same time. It was really weird. And the guy who led the tear gassing was Douglas MacArthur and Dwight D. Eisenhower, and George Patton. Like this was, you know, this is the stuff you don't hear about because this is, you know, eventually they did some better things. Okay, but an impeachment, a battle, and a primary and election was not enough. Roosevelt immediately worked to embarrass the bankers who had caused the crash. Men like Mellon, but not isolated to Mellon. So before the election and into 1934, there was an investigator named Ferdinand Pecora, who's a progressive Republican, and he was working in the Senate Banking Committee. He was exposing the workings of the large financiers who controlled the economy. So he did in-depth research and hearings into major bankers, including the most sacred of all institutions, which was at the time J.P. Morgan. What he revealed a massive network of bribery, which is something called the preferred list. I can explain how that worked if you want. It's not that interesting. It was basically just bribery. And this list had essentially every powerful actor in the country on it, from every CEO of every major company to Supreme Court justices to the Marine general who had led for American forces in World War I. The problems raised by such an institution go far beyond banking regulation in any narrow sense, said Pecora. It might be a formidable rival to government itself. I'm seeing a lot of echoes of Zuckerberg in that. Never before in the history of the United States had so much wealth and power been required to render a public accounting. That's what the Pecora hearings did. They really embarrassed the man who destroyed the country. Out of this came a whole bunch of laws. The Securities Act, the SEC Act, Glass-Steagall to break up the banks, the Airmail Act to break up the airlines and aerospace companies, the Public Utility Holding Company Act to break up utilities, Robinson-Patman Act to block chain stores, secondary mortgage market, the Banking Act to restructure the Federal Reserve, and so forth. And the administration put people on trial. They didn't always win, but they put them on trial. Congress did investigations. The government financed massive industrial projects. The New Deal was a means of seizing power from the financiers and decentralizing it to the people. So Mellon was put on trial, and the prosecutor was a government official named Robert Jackson, who later became a Supreme Court justice, heard the Brown v. Board case, and a prosecutor at Nuremberg. But this was his big break. So it was a bitter trial that exposed Mellon's secrets. And at a certain point when Jackson was being aggressive, they fought back. They started to do a lot of PR, try to subpoena some documents from Jackson. This is usually what happens when you take on powerful people. They go after you personally. And Jackson said, it is Mr. Mellon's creed that $200 million, this was his wealth at the time, can do no wrong. Our offense consists in doubting it. Now, basically from 1932 to 1938, there was a populist movement of policymakers and protesters and lawyers and business people who destroyed the large financial holding companies that ran the economy and created a public governing apparatus and a new set of legal and social norms. Before Rockefeller started his enterprises, wrote Walter Lippmann in 1937, remember, this is the guy who didn't believe in democracy in the 20s. Before Rockefeller started his enterprises, it was not possible to make so much money. Before he died, it had become the settled policy of this country that no man be permitted to make so much money. Okay. And just so you know, Walter Lippmann, my belief was that my view is he's kind of a social climber. He liked the conventional wisdom, right? So if that guy's saying it, it really was the case. And what he was saying, you know, the question that you hear sometimes in the primary, should billionaires exist? Like, they answered that question, and they basically said no. And they said, if you do have a lot of money, you shouldn't be able to use it for political power. Okay, so it's now the 1920s, and the impeachment of Donald Trump is not the same as Andrew Mellon, but there are similarities. We are in a period of deep disillusionment and a move towards more racism rather than more tolerance. We are also 10 years off from a financial crisis, which we never really recovered from, in a war on terror that has lost its legitimacy, if it ever had any. We do have tens of millions of frustrated Americans with student debt, much like World War I veterans, who felt they were promised something that they weren't delivered. Dictatorships are rising all over the world, and liberal democracies are weakening. There is substantial corruption in both political parties, who are very much tied to a concentrated business sector. Just to give you a quick snapshot of a couple of institutions, and this is not all of them, but policies from the 1980s to the 2000s enabled the concentration of power and the formation of institutions like Fox News, MSNBC, Facebook, as well as the destruction of a lot of local newspapers. And these institutions, these institutional changes, tear through the fabric of democracy. They replace actual news, information about what's happening in our society, the watchers over corruption. It replaces them with manipulated gibberish designed to sell ads. Lawlessness at the top is a fairly obvious problem. No one important went to jail for the financial crisis, and big tech companies engage in privacy violation after violation with no meaningful consequences. So this impeachment is an important moment. Because it is what we have a bunch of these moments, but it is yet one more when we can choose to whether to indict Donald Trump for being a bad guy who we don't like, or a great guy who is being framed by a partisan witch hunt. Or it's a moment we can decide that our institutional order itself has frayed, that we the people must retake power, that control of our culture, of our markets, our society, our futures, our liberties, should not be vested in the hands of men like Mark Zuckerberg or Jeff Bezos or private equity barons or student debt servicers or anyone else. Trump, much like Andrew Mellon, is just a symptom of a country that has lost its ability to see or address power. No one ever thought that Andrew Mellon was a good guy. He was a cold banker. Everyone knew he was kind of corrupt. But he stayed in power for 12 years. Because Americans had lost their faith in democracy, in self-government. It's all just gangsters anyway. What's the difference? Now, it was a long road back to democracy. Democracy was always imperfect. And the impeachment of Andrew Mellon was just the start. But we are now in a similar pivotal moment. The physical details, the technical realities, the culture are, of course, not the same as what they were. But the principles, the values, and the threat of concentrated power manipulating and controlling us, these are the same. We regained our liberties then. Can we do it again? Thank you.
I guess the first thing I wanted to ask you about, there was a Democratic primary debate last night. Those of us who were too interested in politics were walking just upstairs from here. So I was just wondering, obviously you have certain ideological wishes within the Democratic Party. So I was just wondering, what were your thoughts on the primary right now?
Okay, so I didn't actually watch the debate.
Okay.
I wanted to watch the debate, but I didn't. Yeah, it's really weird. It's very confusing, and everyone's super passive aggressive, and I don't really understand it, because if there's all this dumb code, nobody wants to make the obvious point that Obama did a bad job. And so we're in a really bad situation. So instead of saying the ACA or Obamacare didn't actually made things worse or didn't improve the situation and things got worse because of a whole series of problems in our healthcare system, the code for that is I like Medicare for all, right? And the code for I like the existing healthcare system or I'm too afraid to change is we need to build on Obamacare. But it's all stupid, right? Because that's neither one actually means what they are saying. What people really want is they don't want healthcare executives to murder you for profit. That's basically what everybody wants, but they're not able to say it because everybody's too afraid to point out that, and I saw this, I worked in Congress, that we didn't solve any of the problems we said we were gonna solve. So I don't understand Democrats these days. I kind of have my preferences as to what I want people to say, but I don't get it, because for me, I got my start in politics in 2002, 2003, and I was a supporter of the war in Iraq, which was just horrible. That was a horrible judgment call on my part, and I tried to figure out why I got it so wrong, and it's okay to get things wrong. It's not, people die, it's a horrible thing, but you should at least admit it and try to figure it out. And what is so weird about this moment is that we obviously did a lot of things wrong. Obviously our policies led to a dumpster fire, and there's this total unwillingness to acknowledge that. And so it's really hard to move forward. So the debate is all very weird and coded and doesn't really make any sense. So it's that's kind of my sense. I like Bernie and I like Warren, right? That's who I like, because they're the ones who are talking sort of about concentrated power. But it's really confusing, and there's a reason that their stuff doesn't sell more broadly than it, than it's selling.
Right? Yeah, but one reason for that is, you talked about the 1920s and the 1930s and and the sort of resurgence in progressivism and populism. But that was a much worse economic circumstance than now, right? I mean, you can talk about corruption and structural flaws in our economy, but the reality is, you know, majority of Americans... a majority of Americans think the economy is going in the right direction, right? Even as there's a lot of dissatisfaction, a lot of it is partisan, right? Whoever's president, the other party hates how things are going in Washington. Right. But right now, most Americans say the economy is doing fine. Most Americans seem to think society is doing fine. In the Democratic primary, two of the leading candidates in Biden and Buttigieg are essentially candidates of the Obama era status quo, more or less explicitly. And there seems to be that most Democrats say, well, if we tinker around the edges, we go back to the Obama economy, things weren't so bad. So do you really think we're in enough of a crisis moment to, like, overcome these entrenched forces? Because it was a lot worse in the Depression.
In 1932, it was. It was really awful. But 1932 is not the only analogy. So there was 1912. 1912, you saw a radical realignment of politics. And the economy was doing fine in 1912. The main problem was what was called the cost of living, which is basically what the healthcare problem is today. Healthcare is just too expensive and corrupt. It's just fairly similar, not healthcare, other staples. So you don't have to have a world war and a depression to make any changes. There's this narrative that, like, everything has to collapse before we can change things, and that's not true. I don't agree that Biden and Buttigieg are actually saying let's go back to the Obama era. This gets to the passive aggressiveness thing, because they're saying, if they said it explicitly, they would be endorsing all of those policies that Obama, you know, put forward, and they're not. They're saying we need to move forward, we need to build on Obamacare, we need to, you know, we have lots of problems with banks or with corruption, with monopolies, whatever it is, all of these things. And it's, you don't see anybody really saying, let's just go back to that. Like, the way you see them talking about Obama is you see them saying, he was so great, he was graceful and he was honest. And, like, it's very, like, processy. It's not like, he did these awesome things to, like, get us all, you know, free internet or whatever it is. We should do that again. It's more like a kind of nostalgia for the man, but a rejection of the policies, even though I agree with you that they're more or less saying that. That's only because they're saying that to you, they're saying that to me, because we're Democrats and we understand the code. But to most people, they're trying to project a I'm gonna change things type of frame. And if you listen to the language, they actually are sort of saying that. And that's why it's such a weird election, because, like, they're saying different things to different audiences, and we're sort of living in bubbles. Okay. And yeah.
Well, all right. Well, to the other side of that bubble, then, at least within the Democratic Party, you said you like Warren and Sanders, and there seems like a pretty standard left-wing critique of Democrats. Say, you know, there's like one party in this country. Democrats are too pro-business. Hillary Clinton was too friendly with Wall Street, etc. And it's a pretty standard critique. There's too much income inequality. But so I was just wondering, your criticism of monopoly seems sort of like a technocratic variety of that. Like, you're focusing on a specific variety. But so do you think it's in the broad tradition of, like, the almost socialist critique of the Democratic Party, or is it more nuanced?
No, it's not. And it's a Jeffersonian critique, right? Or Brandeisian critique. So it's what I'm saying is that, so how we do, it's a pro-business critique, right?
Yeah.
So the populist farmers in the 1880s and 1890s and the merchants, and they were angry at monopoly. They were angry at the railroads, they were angry at the bankers, and they saw them as a central government that was restraining business. So business and commerce, how we do business and commerce, is how we do justice. So if you think about, like, Plessy versus Ferguson, right? The segregation case in 1896 that structures Jim Crow. That was a railroad case. It's a case about a railroad, right? Discrimination on a railroad. You think about the 1963 Civil Rights Act, right? That was, Title II was about whether hotels and restaurant owners had to serve black people or not. It's commercial regulation, right? It's the definition of property rights bakes in our ideas of social justice. You could go on and on and on and on and find that much of the way that we do social justice is structured around how we do business. And I come out of the tradition that says we should do business by putting property broadly in the hands of the people, and we should pull the intermediaries, the monopolists, the bankers, concentrated power out of our way so that we can be a free people. And there's social safety nets and various other things that are involved. But ideologically, what the argument is, that is a way of having a democracy that has egalitarian economic roots and political roots. And the socialists don't believe that. They're confused too, but they come out of a different, because you always see, I'm like, well, this is what I think. We should decentralize things and have markets, but have it basically be equal. And they're like, well, but we don't like that. But we're not against markets because we don't want a large administrative bureaucracy to distribute things. And it's like, okay, well then what are we really debating here, right? It's like socialism and capitalism are brands. And like nobody, you know, a farmer's market is not the same thing as a derivatives market. Right? They both have the word market in it. Why are people like, you like markets? And it's like, well, I like farmers markets. I don't like derivatives markets. Like, they're just different. And why don't we just like talk like normal people do, right? And recognize that like socialism, capitalism, these are not things. These are just air, it's like punching clouds. It doesn't make any sense. Sorry, I guess I'm a little hopped up on this because the left keeps attacking me for being technocratic or whatever. And I'm like,
which side of the left? The socialist left?
The socialist left. I mean, and also the, like, they're all the same. Like, the neoliberals and the socialist left, they're all just like, oh, he doesn't understand things. He's just talking about all the money and power in the world. That's not, you know, it's like, what? Like, they control everything. They have all the money and power in the world. And you're like, oh, your frame is too small. It's all the money and power in the world.
All right, that's fair. All right, but so...
it's okay.
No, it's good. It's good to hear about...
It took me 20 years to figure this out.
Okay, that's good. But so, you can take some of their money and some of their power without necessarily breaking up monopolies. Like, there's a ton of argument of income inequality. Like, you have Jeff Bezos, he owns a lot of Amazon. You could take a lot of that. You could give it to people, right? You have big corporations, they're publicly traded. They could be owned by pension funds and sovereign wealth funds. Can we restructure, but some of these monopolies have real advantages. They have economies of scale. Some of them are natural network effects. Yeah. Can we restructure our economy by just redistributing the gains to these while keeping the efficiencies? Or is it fundamentally not practical?
No, yeah, you can have. I mean, so we can distinguish between the flight, right? Flight is amazing. Like, baggage fees from American Airlines suck. And they're not the same thing, right? So we have all these incredible technologies, some of which require scale and some of which don't. And then you have these political institutions called corporations and banks. And you have these markets with rules that we write. And you can write those rules however you want, consistent with technical and physical realities. So, like, you can have a Facebook and Instagram, and they can both be part of this financial conglomerate called Facebook. Or you can have them just be separate entities that are competing. And, you know, there are maybe some economies of scale with something like maybe Google Search in some ways. But there's no reason that Google Search and YouTube have to be in the same company. These are just political choices. There's a complex way to talk about this. But basically what you want to do is where you have no economies of scale, then you should try to keep the institutions as small as possible. This would be things like farming and retail and banking. And when you have economies of scale, like, you need some scientific or engineering input, you need to have some scale, right? Like, you should have like a, you're not gonna have a family run steel mill, right? But you can have multiple steel companies. Like, one steel mill has an economy of scale, maybe 10 steel mills don't. That's just an administrative decision. So have some economies of scale there, keep the markets competitive, and then put in place protections for workers. And also regulate the market. Let me just step back to something very basic. I come from a tradition which is producerism, which is to say people that do the work should get the profit, right? It's very simple. And that flows through every legal framework. So patents should be used to protect the engineer, not the financier. Copyright should be used to protect the artist, not the corporation. Farm supports should be used to protect the farmer, not the large landowner. Government procurement should be used to decentralize power, not concentrated in the hands of Lockheed Martin. You go down, you know, labor law should be used to protect workers in large industrial corporations, but if it's a small company, you just want a lot of them, because you don't want to bureaucratize a company that's just 15 people, because that's super annoying and hard to manage. You're not going to get any startups. But you also don't want to imprison people in small companies, so you want a lot of them so people can leave if their boss is an asshole, right? So the idea is that in every sector, they keep things as small as possible, consistent with technical requirements. And you have network things too, like Facebook or telecommunications or airlines, what you want to do there is you want to break them up if you can, but if you can't, if there are network economies, keep them neutral. So that, you know, Mark Zuckerberg can't, he shouldn't be making the decisions that he's making. You know, why are we begging him to make decisions about our politics? That's a function of the fact that Facebook is a non-neutral network. It's run based on advertising, and that's a big problem. So the same thing is true across a lot of our networks. Don't allow price discrimination, don't allow non-neutrality. But the basic idea is protect the people that do the work from the people that want to control them.
Okay. All right, well, now I want to talk about fascism for a moment, or more specifically, the political right, because you've talked about how the movement against monopolies is not just unique to the left. You've talked about, like, Senators Josh Hawley and Tom Cotton. Right. But when I listen to Senators Josh Hawley and Tom Cotton, and I hear them, in Hawley's case, conclude a rousing speech in which he denounces cosmopolitan bankers and financial
elites.
Elites, okay, right, yes. Right. All right, not quite as bad. Right. I don't feel particularly safe. And I listen to something like that, and I think that when the right is turning on business, it is often as part of a much more pernicious turn against democracy. And so I wonder, you view these people potentially as allies, but if you look at right-wing populist governments that have humbled democracy, in many cases destroyed it, many of them oppose businesses. It's really good politics. You said it's really popular. So is there a safe strain of anti-monopoly politics on the right? Because it's good politics. You said people don't like this stuff. People don't like Jeff Bezos. But it's very easy to sort of marry it with demagogic nationalism, racism, et cetera. So do you think these people really are good allies?
It depends on the right winger you're talking about, just like I think it depends on the left winger. So Ted Cruz is not a good faith ally.
Okay.
Like Ted Cruz... will come out against Google and Facebook, and he will say things that are intended to bully Google and Facebook into promoting conservative content and downgrading left-wing content, right? And when you have the fusion of, and I think Donald Trump, very similar, like you have the fusion of concentrated corporate power and concentrated political power, and that is fascism, right? That's what it is. Now, it's not, we're not there yet. We're in a sort of soft corporatist state, but that's what fascism actually is. And it's a form of totalitarianism. When the government takes over business, that's communism. When business takes over government, it's fascism. They're both, you know, when you centralize power, you move to totalitarianism. And there, on the right, there's a long tradition of disliking this. Friedrich Hayek wrote a book called The Road to Serfdom, where he talked a lot about how he didn't like big government or unions, but he also didn't like monopolies, because he saw it all as a variant of central planning. That's the same thing as Brandeis. That's what he thought. He was on probably the Democratic, the left side of the aisle. So I think Ted Cruz, I think Donald Trump, I think they're engaging in bad faith. You can see that they don't care. They don't move policy when conservatives aren't looking. And when they are moving policy, it's often to benefit their side. Well, I look at Josh Hawley, and I've seen he does a lot of things to attack Facebook and Google and their power in ways that are very healthy, and he works with Democrats, and he does it when people aren't looking. So when it's not a benefit to him, and I give him credit for taking on some of the most powerful people in the world, and it offends me that Democrats don't do it. And the way I think about this stuff is it's like the right is really reexamining their view of the world right now. And it's real. And I talked to a lot of people there on the right. I talked to a lot of people in the Pentagon. I mean, you know, like, boomers are terrible, right? Like, boomers are awful. They fucked everything up. And that's true in the Republican Party. It's true in the Democratic Party. It's true in every institution. They've learned some really bad lessons. And they're all changing. But I think you're right to say that there is a dangerous strain, I think, of Steve Bannon types who are using this rhetoric in ways that are designed to concentrate power in dangerous ways. That's a huge problem. But the way to defeat that problem, the way to, you know, and even though Josh Hawley he's a social conservative, right? So he wants to run a socially conservative world where you decentralize power. But it's not the world that I want to see, because I'm not a social conservative. Though I have a lot of respect for him, the way to defeat that is to just have the Democrats do it, right? I mean, that's how you defeat it. You don't defeat it by saying, you know, Norms, I'm going to call the hall monitor, which is like the standard instinct from Democratic Party, right? Yeah. And so that's the way you don't defeat right-wing forces, autocratic forces, fascist forces by trying to tattle to the teacher, right? You don't ask Robert Mueller to do your work for you. You actually make people's lives better. And that's what Democrats don't do. Or at least they haven't done, you know, in my lifetime.
Yeah. Okay. All right, well, so relating to that, you mentioned that fascism is, I think you said, the capture of the state by industry.
Right.
But, you know, I mean, if you look at Nazi Germany, Italy, et cetera, certainly there's business involvement with the state, but the initial driving force, what first seizes the state, is like this virulently nationalist, militaristic movement.
Right.
And, I mean, you talk about this in the United States, you center business, right? This is, it's not a Marxist critique, but it's the same idea that material effects are driving politics. But Donald Trump is not, he ran certainly on some economic issues, but what predicted votes for him was immigration, social resentment, et cetera. What caused the rise of these fascist movements is these incredibly powerful, virulent, militaristic movements. So I'm just saying, it seems interesting to me, you mentioned not calling the hall monitor, and I think that's true. Sadly, doesn't work in politics very much. But do you think viewing politics through this lens is dangerous? Because, like, monopoly does not explain the rise of Adolf Hitler, and it does not explain the rise of Viktor Orban.
Well, what describes the rise of Adolf Hitler is the Treaty of Versailles.
Yeah.
Destroying, you know, and the financial arrangements of Andrew Mellon. And, you know, we pretend like Adolf Hitler came from nowhere, that Germany just suddenly got really anti-Semitic. The guy ran for office. He didn't win a majority, but he ran attacking the Treaty of Versailles and saying, we're not going to pay our debts. He was the only one saying, we're not going to pay the debts. Those are illegitimate. Oh, and by the way, it's, you know, very anti-Semitic ways of characterizing what was going on. And even still, with 40% unemployment, just desperation in Germany, most people didn't vote for him. But no one else was willing to actually, you know, he was manipulating people. He was a fascist. He was Adolf Hitler. But nobody else was able to craft a framework that let Germany break from the existing financial arrangements, which were catastrophic. And I looked at a bunch of speeches from the 1930s because I was like, well, today online, when you get into an argument, you know, it ends with someone calling someone else Hitler, right? What did they do before Hitler was Hitler, right? When he was just a thug, before he had done, like, before he became brand Hitler. And so I was like, what are these, you know, so I looked at a bunch of speeches and it was all these politicians being like, trying to say, that guy's really bad news. Like, that's Adolf Hitler. But nobody knew who that was because he hadn't done what he did yet.
Yeah.
And it was like, people kind of knew what he was about, but the first people to notice him, there's two groups of people to notice him. The first were Jewish congressmen, right, for obvious reasons. The second were people in the banking committee. So LaGuardia was one, he was on the banking committee, and it was because they understood that the financial arrangements, the pressing, the crushing of Germany through our debt arrangements, we were demanding that England and France repay us for what we had, the weapons we had sold to them during World War I, and they in turn demanded reparations for Germany that was crushing the German economy. And so it was this arrangement where if we forgave debts, they would forgive debts on Germany. And so there was this, there were these arguments, and LaGuardia was saying, this is causing massive, massive social problems in Germany, and we're gonna have to send an army over there again if we don't fix it. Right, if we don't do that, and we didn't fix it in time. So I think when you're looking at fascism, I mean, and Mussolini, he emerged in 21, 22, 23, and one of the main reasons is because the Italian government cut bread subsidies. They engaged in austerity politics, and there were all of these veterans of World War I who knew how to fight. They were trained in weapons. And he recruited them into gangs to take over the state. And he aligned with the church and he aligned with the king, the conservative forces. But there was a tremendous amount of anger at austerity that the Italian kind of then quasi-democratic government had engaged in. So, you know, and I don't want to take issue with the framing around resentment and Trump, because I don't agree with that.
Well,
but,
fair enough.
But
yeah.
I mean, obviously there's a lot of racism, but racism is a learned attitude too.
Yeah. But
by political economics as well.
Your argument then is that fascism is not when monopolies take over the state, or fascism is caused. Yes, fascism is caused by the economic deprivation resulting from governments that are unable to protect their citizens from monopoly.
Robert Jackson said this in 1938. You know, there's this big book of Americans that don't like Hitler and the Nazis, and he wrote this and what they're doing to the Jews, and he was like, you know, part of fascism is racial intolerance or ethnic intolerance or religious intolerance. Part of it is, and fortunately in America, we don't have that. I was like, oh.
Not as much.
It's true, actually, that the Hitler kept trying to entice the American South, being like, hey, we're not so different, you and I. And the South was like, fuck you. I don't understand, whatever. Anyway, Robert Jackson wrote that fascism also comes from the fact that there's one dinner for two men, or one dinner for two men's families, right? And that's, so part of it is, you know, and you can look at this, like, a lot of the history, there's a wonderful historian named Judith Stein who wrote a couple of books about the steel industry and then about finance in the 70s. She got her start writing about Marcus Garvey. It's an important figure in civil rights, black politics. And what she noted was that a lot of the riots that took place in the mid-60s happened in areas where there was deindustrialization, early deindustrialization of steel, particularly in the steel industry. And what it did is it set, so the way that unionized workplaces worked in those days is that you, and I guess still today, to the extent that you have unions, is that you got seniority. And if there were layoffs, the most recently hired would get laid off. But that was fine as long as the industry was expanding. And most of the workers who were senior were white because they had been hired earlier. And it was fine as long as the industry was growing. And then there were a series of decisions which had to do with the Cold War and had to do with some things I argue in my book that started shrinking the steel industry and handing over steel industry to sort of allies. And then what ended up happening is all the black workers got laid off. And then civil rights groups came in, and instead of saying, hey, grow the industry so that you have more jobs, they started saying, well, that the union is racist. You should lay the white workers off. And it's like, okay, yeah, if you're going to be fair about it, you should. But what's a better way to generate racial conflict than to say, we're going to have a fight over whether the white workers or the black workers get access to high-paying jobs or poverty, right? So, yeah, there's racism, and that's racism is... It drives a lot of this activity, but racism can be made better or it can be made worse. And a lot of the institutional decisions and the history of how we understand these institutional decisions kind of leaves out these strategic choices. And I think one of the exciting parts of this current moment is there is a school of history that's coming back called the History of Capitalism. This book is part of that tradition, which is looking at these institutional arrangements and saying, actually, we have to understand how our businesses work and how people experience those business arrangements to understand the broader cultural trends as well. Okay. You guys, do you still date? Is that the thing that young people do?
Monopolies haven't destroyed that yet.
Yeah.
Give it some time.
Yeah.
All right, we're live? Okay. All right, one final question, and then I'll turn it over to the audience. Bernie or Warren? I've got to ask.
I'm undecided.
Okay.
I have things I like about each and things
What are some, from your point of view of your politics, what are some key differences between them?
I don't think they're really, I think ideologically they both come out of the populist tradition. Okay. So I write a lot about Wright Patman in here, is the guy that I was talking about who impeached Mellon. In the 1970s, Bernie, he was the chair of the banking committee from 1961 to 1975. He wrote these incredible reports on the power of banks over corporations and on chain banking. Bernie in the 1970s, when he was running for Congress, used to carry these reports around with him and talk about them. He really hasn't changed, but the material has. So he comes out of that populist tradition. He did a number of things to prevent consolidation, particularly in the defense industry in the 90s. Wants to break up banks, which, you know, is standard anti-monopoly principle. And I think Elizabeth Warren comes out of the financial crisis, and she, the strong anti-monopolist, has given a number of important speeches, really the first one to talk about breaking up big tech. Hostile to like Tim Geithner and basically both Bernie and Warren come out of the anti-monopoly tradition. They come out of the anti kind of Tim Geithner world. They're on my side on the financial crisis, right? I would say my general observation about them is like what I'm looking for from Bernie is to demonstrate that he can govern, that he has detail oriented, that he has the ability to operationalize what he's saying, and I've been impressed by his campaign. So, and I think for Warren, I believe she's a good hard-charging bureaucratic leader. She can make bureaucracies do things. She's pretty awesome and vicious in that way. Man, you should watch her. I won't say some of the, but she's great. Her instincts that way. But, you know, I think her campaign reflects some instincts that I think are, there's some learning, right? So, like, there was a coup in Bolivia, right? I mean, a right-wing military coup, which was pretty obviously a right-wing military coup, because they, like, are killing protesters and, like, saying we're going to arrest everyone in parliament. These are, like, standard signals that, like, you're having a military coup. I don't know. It's always hard to identify these. I don't like dealing with foreign policy, national security issues, because everyone's always lying. And so it's just kind of hard to know. But I think that that's a military coup. And she didn't come out and say it, and Bernie did. And so it's like, as somebody, you know, I got into politics because I was so wrong on Iraq, right? And I was wrong for the worst reasons. I believed all the fancy people who told me, yes, we have to murder lots of people. And I was like, well, absolutely. I believe fancy things, so that's what we should do. And I'm like, I kind of lost... It was really disillusioning to realize that you can make the decision to murder a lot of people or to do really terrible things. And I feel like that's just, there's a couple of things that, you know, we need to be very clear about, and that's something that we have to be really clear about, which is that when something like that happens, we just do not, we at least do not endorse it. And Warren didn't endorse it. Warren talked about the interim government and stuff, but it's just kind of like, that's something where you should come out. I'm not saying that I haven't chosen one or the other. And I'm still waiting and learning, but I like the fact that they have to compete with each other. I like the fact that there's a debate. I think it's cool, and I like that. I like these arguments. I think it's been a good primary so far, if passive aggressive.
All right. I guess one final question off that. Is there anyone else in the primary who speaks to your ideas?
Well, they all kind of speak to it a little bit.
Yeah.
I can go over each of them, but that's,
no. Yeah,
that's
I think
the,
that's
the gist
yeah.
I think that there's a lot of them. You know, the. You know, look, just to give you a sense of how it's changed, you know, in 2016, everyone knew that one of Clinton's most important cabinet members was going to be Sheryl Sandberg, right, from Facebook, right? It was, like, obvious, and this was not, like, a bad thing. I mean, I thought it was bad, but most people were like, oh, she's great, Facebook's awesome and progressive, and this is really great. And now it's like, that is crazy. It's a crazy idea, right? It's crazy for everyone. So things have moved, like, radically. And I'm not a huge fan of Buttigieg, for example. Yeah. But last night he talks about Monopoly. So it's like, you know,
okay.
That's...
All right. Well, that's a good note to end on. Yeah. All right.
This kind of goes off Dan's last questions, which is why I'm coming in now. Maybe this is redundant. If so, ignore it. But basically, could you describe in some detail, with no constraints, your ideal Democratic candidate?
My belief is that it's not about the candidates. The candidates are responding to us. They're responding to what we think, to our assumptions. And yeah, there's leadership that you can show. But I think that it's really hard for any candidate to be honest about the problems we're facing, because we had so much corruption in both parties. And on the Republican side, it's really hard to say Trump's a bad guy. We have a lot of corruption, we have to get rid of it. Some people are talking that way, but it's hard to do it when you lose your career. And on the Democratic side, it's hard to say this, it's hard to say that as well. It's hard to say, wow, we really did a bad job on all of these things, and there's a reason that people are disillusioned and alienated, and it's partially our fault. We're the bad guys. Nobody wants to, like, that's the problem, and if you don't have a mass group of people that are willing to reckon with that, you can design, I could design in a lab the perfect candidate, but they wouldn't win, right? Because the voters are the ones, we are a democracy, we really are. And like, what that means is that when we have bad ideas and bad assumptions and bad histories in our heads, we do bad things. And we have to reckon with that. And I want to see leadership, you know, that can actually talk to the crises that we ourselves induced.
What is your deepest explanation of why there isn't more receptivity toward such a candidate in the U.S. electorate?
Well, I think you see this everywhere. So in England, right, like you're seeing there's a lot of anger at like Jeremy Corbyn. There's like the third wave thing. In Germany, you see the Social Democrats, who are basically the Democratic Party there. They're having a really hard time reckoning with their what they did, which was very similar. Like, what's happening is a breakdown of corporatism. And like there was this idea that came out of the, like basically the arrangement that came out in the 1950s after there was sort of a truce between big business and forces of democracy was like, okay, we'll leave a bunch of big companies in the economy, but you have to treat people right. You have to be unionized. You can't screw your suppliers. We're going to have a body of laws that like allows people to have remedies if you go too far. And that memory of, and you know, one of the things that happened is the labor union leaders were like, we're very important because we get to sit down at important tables and make these decisions. And there's still this remnant, there's still this belief among, I think, a lot of institutional players in the Democratic Party and Republican Party that there's this social deal. But that social deal is gone. It is frayed. It's true in Germany. That social deal is dying. And there are a bunch of bad ideas and bad history in people's heads, but they're trying to sort of hold on to that. And they're trying to hold on to it. And there's a larger ideological problem where we were taught, at least my generation was taught, I think the generations in the 1970s and before, or 1970s and afterwards, were taught that political economy was not part of politics. Corporate power and banking power were not part of politics. These were just neutral institutions. So during the financial crisis, banks and corporations, I thought these were just, there was just a technical problem as opposed to what it really was, which was a political and constitutional problem. And that's an whole ideology that writes power out of politics, shrinks politics to these kind of narrow process questions which we're dealing with, like, are you a moderate or are you a progressive? Do you want revolution? It's all just garbage. Like, it's all stupid to make those arguments. But that comes from an ideological problem that we never learned, like, this history. We never learned that there were these battles. Just to give you a sense, one of the people that designed our modern historical framework is a guy named Richard Hofstadter, who was a socialist, actually. He was at Columbia. And one of the things he said was that ideologically, there was no difference between Franklin Delano Roosevelt and Herbert Hoover. So there's really no difference. They believe the same thing. They were both capitalists. Herbert Hoover was just like a cold guy, and FDR was like warm, and like other people trusted him. That was the difference. Like, this was the main, like, this was the guy that created the historical framework, really post-1950. That's the history that we learned. And if you believe that, if you believe there are no differences, that we've always been capitalist, if you flatten history so there are no fights, you have no tradition to see power and to see these fights. And that's, I think, the main problem, is people really have a hard time understanding that what democracy did once work.
I have two questions specifically about the theme of big tech. The first is that it seems there's this large push in Congress to have regulation of big tech companies, where we've seen congressional hearings in which representatives of the major tech companies have been summoned. There was an announcement that many state attorneys generals have announced an investigation into Google. And so I'm curious what you think might come, if anything might come from these efforts to regulate these companies. And kind of a second question I have is that with Warren's push to try to break up companies such as Facebook, I'm curious what you think would be the best way for the government to break up companies such as Facebook if it chose to do so.
Great questions. They're great questions because I know the answers. Yeah, okay, so where's this going? I mean, and then what should you do? I think I'm gonna just, it's the same answer. You basically have, these companies are too big. Google has 8 products with more than 1 billion users. Facebook has 3 products, has 2.5 billion users. This is crazy big, you can't manage it. They're also killing newspapers. 2,000 of America's 3,000 counties now have no daily newspaper. This is a crisis, it's a really big problem. And what's effectively happened is that, oh, I don't have my phone's over there, but it was gonna be very dramatic. I was gonna pull my phone out, it's just a prop. I was gonna say, we've taken a supercomputer, imagine this is a phone, right? This supercomputer. And this could be a tool of liberty, it could be a tool to tell stories, but it is instead a leash. And that's a crazy way to organize a society, to turn our best technology into constraints on us. So as an example, Andrew Yang talks about this dystopian future of robots, where all these robots are gonna come and make anything that we want, and that's somehow bad, right? That's how afraid we are of this wonderful technology that we have. But that's all a business model problem, right? We didn't used to be afraid of the future. We used to do shows like The Jetsons. That was like a cool future, right? And now, you guys watch you guys watched the Jet back in my, when we had onions on our belt, we had this cartoon called the Jetsons, you know, the futuristic stuff. The future was cool, and now the future is dystopian, and that's because technology has more and more fallen under the control of monopolists who use that technology to manipulate and control us, right? So it always, stuff always gets cooler and more dystopian instead of cooler and more liberating, right? Stuff used to get more liberating, now it gets more dystopian. So what do you do with companies like Google and Facebook and Amazon? There's three things. First, enforce the rule of law. And I know this sounds really basic, but it's like when these guys break the law, which they do all the time, don't give them a ticky-tack parking fine. Put some handcuffs on someone, right? Because they'll keep doing it. If it's a parking fine, they won't care. So put some handcuffs. That's what you got to do, or threaten to put handcuffs. Number two, simplify these business models, because they're just too big, and they are also the result of mergers. They're not the result of innovation in a garage. They're the result of roll-ups. In 1901, U.S. Steel was formed out of 4,000 different companies. Google and Facebook are similar from 2004 to 2014. They bought hundreds of companies for tens of billions of dollars in the ad tech space. Just unwind those to simplify their business structure so you can actually understand what they're doing and so that there's some competition. And then the third is to, once you've broken them up and broken their power, regulate the markets consistent with your values. So if you care a lot about privacy, make sure that there's a lot of controls over private data. If you don't care that much about privacy, then allow more use of data. But don't allow Google to use data and no one else to use data. Let everybody use it or no one use it, right? So then it's fair, right? And that's no, it's not creepy. Like. So regulate, and you can regulate in a number of different ways. You can change advertising markets, because these are ad firms, right? People want to make it all scary, you know, scare stories, talk about surveillance capitalism or whatever. These are just ad firms, like they sell soap, right? That's what they do. So it's not that big a deal to change their ad models. You can regulate data, you regulate privacy, you can regulate, there's a whole bunch of different things that you can do, but basically structure, it's regulated competition. Right, regulate the business practices in the markets that we create by making structural kind of separation. And you need to do that with more than just big tech. You need to do it with Disney. You need to probably do it with Boeing. You probably need to do it on Wall Street. You need to do it, you know, with Monsanto, Bayer, and a whole bunch of different other companies across the economy. But that's the basic principle: break up, regulate the markets, and also make sure that you're enforcing the law on the powerful.
You talked about these problems being institutional. And so like what I'm curious about is, in the instance of Facebook, let's just throw out a hypothetical where they come in and they break up Facebook. We still live in this society where people are walking platforms. I mean, I don't think anyone is more influential on women under the age of 30 than Beyonce. I mean, Beyonce probably has more influence on politics than Mark Zuckerberg.
Don't talk about her.
I mean, we can break up these institutions, but what about the underlying problems with kind of these celebrities having so much influence on politics?
One of the things that you saw in the 1970s was, you used to have lots of local stores. You didn't used to have like Best Buy. You would have a camera store, and they would, all the prices were the same. And there's a lot of reasons for this, but basically what happened is there was a roll up of power. It wasn't because Best Buy was more efficient. And these stores competed on salesmanship. Go into a clothing store, they would have a salesperson that was experienced that could sell you clothes that looked good on you, right? Now it's racks of clothing that's cheap. You don't necessarily have that same system. So they competed on quality and service. And there were a lot of stores. And they were often family owned. And then we saw there were changes to a couple of pricing laws. And these changes had a couple of impacts. One of which is you saw a massive roll up of power and the explosion of chains. This is like the Limited or the shopping mall in the 1980s. All that stuff happened because we changed our pricing laws. The consequence of that is they started to compete on the shoddiness of the product and only on price. And then the number of independent stores collapsed. And the number of salespeople collapsed, and the experience of salespeople collapsed. Now, what took its place? Branding. TV commercials. The culture of celebrity took its place. Became much more important because you didn't actually have people there that you could trust who had expertise in buying things or selling things. So part of what we have to do as a culture is we have to decide that we want more human scale relationships. We need more civic leadership in the form of people who run stores or people that run farms or people that run newspapers. And we shouldn't try to automate everything from these kind of distant masters. And we can do that if we just, you know, we used to do it. We just do that and we change the laws to enable that. I mean, today a local store is like seen as, an avocado toast or whatever in Brooklyn. It's like a bougie thing. But that was everywhere in America prior to the 1980s. That's just what America was. So get back to that, right? That change, I mean, you're always gonna have we're always gonna have Beyonce, and that's good, not bad. And I resent the implication otherwise. I don't have a total answer to that, but I do think that there's something about the collapse of civic leadership that's leading. And I think the other thing is that because everything is increasingly a scam, like we don't enforce laws against fraud, with the law, the breakdown of law, everything is a scam. So people are often just trying to get famous because that seems to be the only way that you can actually acquire any money or power. And that creates a really stressful, shitty culture. Because then it doesn't matter if you're a good engineer, you have to be a good self-promoter. It doesn't matter if you're, and that I think creates this like reverence for branding and, you know, Instagram influencing and you know, all the rest of that. So.
Yeah, so I wanted to ask about antitrust law. So it seems like the standard has kind of been watered down to the point where the only standard is basically efficiency in the law of whether or not you should break something up. So I'm wondering how we got to that point and what you think the standard should be. You're kind of touching on this with Deja's question, but so what should that standard be if not?
Yeah, so I wrote it down. So what you're referring to is what's called the consumer welfare standard. So the way that we didn't, in the 1970s when we got rid of antitrust law, we didn't actually change the statutes. What we did is we changed the interpretation of the law. So it used to be that when you were saying, is this market competitive, you would look at it and you would say, well, how many competitors are there? If there are a lot of competitors, then it's competitive. If there are very few competitors, it's not. That's basically the way it worked. This is called the structure conduct performance paradigm. And then in the 1970s, they said, that's crazy. You can have a market with one player or two players that can be very competitive because that one player might be the only one in the market, but they're afraid because at any point someone else could come into the market. So there's this latent competition in there if they're making too much money, right? The way you tell whether there's competition is you just look at consumer prices. And this was one of the ways the right tricked the left is they said, we just want consumer prices. And the left, which was at that point, a lot of them were consumer rights people, and they conceived of themselves not as citizens or producers, but as consumers. That was the big change that happened. They were like, that makes sense. And we can get these technocrats, these economists, to explain to us through these complicated models how to get low prices. This is one of the reasons we saw Walmart explode. Walmart's slogan in the 80s and 90s, everyday low prices. Right? That's the, who cares if it's big and really powerful and controls what we can buy? Everyday low prices. That there's no such thing as power. Just look at efficiency and consumer welfare. So that's how it happened in the 1970s. There was a change in interpretation through the courts. And you go into lots of different areas of political economy now, and there's this obsession with consumer, whether there's something's good for the end consumer. They're about to destroy a whole bunch of independent movie theaters because of something that the antitrust division did earlier this week. And they're like, we don't care. As long as people can see, consumers can see movies, we're fine with that. And that's a change in the way that we understand antitrust law. I think the standard should just be whether there's competition, whether there's power, whether there are multiple competitors in a market. So we need to care about the competitive process. So I would just go back to structuralism.
So you talked a little bit about student debt, you sort of casually mentioned it throughout your talk, but I guess I was wondering, you know, what do you see as the big connection between student debt and large corporations? And I guess, what do you do about those connections? And I guess by like the biggest connection, I mean the most influential, the one that's, you know, causing the most problems with student debt.
Yeah, I mean, well, first of all, the student debt industry is very concentrated, and the customer service, you know, it's all, it's designed to sort of trick and trap you. But it's more a philosophical change to the same movement, the law and economics movement. And I think a lot on the sort of the liberal side, they have moved our society towards, but basically we rewrote the social contract and used a whole bunch of public goods, things like education or healthcare, various other things that were low cost or free. We've decided that, and government services too, we've decided that these should not be public goods anymore, and that they should be delivered by the private sector, by the financial sector. So it was part of that ideological shift. So as an example, college, you know, the city of New York university system used to be free. It was free from the 1840s all the way to 1975. And when New York City went bankrupt, one of the things that the federal government demanded, and this was actually, I think, Dick Cheney demanded, he was the deputy chief of staff of the Ford White House, he demanded that the CUNY system start charging tuition. It was true, Ronald Reagan in the 60s, when he was governor of California, one of the things he did is the California public university system was amazing, it was also free. He said, we're gonna start charging tuition. And it was because it was a change from seeing people as citizens and seeing education as a public good towards seeing people as kind of consumers who should be servicing debts. And that change, that ideological change happened kind of slowly and then quickly. And that's, there's a whole bunch of arguments that go into the way that we understand education. But that would be my way of looking at that problem.
It seems to me like you're sort of reframing this argument from the 1930s and positioning people who have actually done the most to drive the country forward. Like the obvious part might be to call the captains of industry robber barons. And I mean, when the truth is that there are like five people or, you know, more, but they push the whole country and make it a superpower and that is able to help things move into the future. The thing with the student debt, in a way, is that it also seems to me like you're framing things in a way that like the government doesn't actually, like the centralized power that you're pushing for, like the gun to regulate these people like Facebook and Instagram and Google, is the centralized power of government. And that seems a whole lot scarier to me and a whole lot of other people than the power that, say, Facebook or Apple. Apple might prove even more hurtful to the economy because they deliberately do things like provide us needless upgrades and keep us attached to our phone that we just keep making us buy new products that we actually don't need anymore. But their market share is dropping, and so that if you let it go long enough, there's sort of like a natural curve that they'll actually go out of business. And more and more people, I don't know a single person that actually likes Facebook. So it's estimated that their user base is actually dropping. What it seems to me that this push is really the government's desire to get control over our information and not let it be controlled by private people that have done the most to kind of revolutionize and create tons of jobs, when admittedly you say the government and the Democrats do a very bad job of making our lives better, when these people have actually done a very good job historically. So I wonder if you can answer some of those, respond to that.
Yeah, I think that's... So, okay, let me see if I'll just take the whole, so the question is not, 1970s created this sort of language of deregulation, right? Which is kind of a misnomer, because it's not, Amazon has these jobs, these job listings, for was it policy enforcer? It's a job. You go on the LinkedIn, you can find these jobs. I think it's Amazon, might be Facebook. This is not somebody that does public policy. This is somebody that enforces Amazon's rules on Amazon's marketplace. Amazon is regulating the marketplace. And Google regulates, if you go on, like a lot of their, what they do is they regulate advertising practices on the internet. They regulate standards on the internet. And Visa and MasterCard, they have regulatory policies because they're, when you have that much market power, you are a private government. So it's not a question of whether we're being regulated or not. It's not a question of whether we're being governed or not. It's a question of who governs. And right now what's happening is the people who are governing are unaccountable and they're in these private, concentrated institutions. There is a narrative that I think you're using, which I think is very common, which is the sort of the captain of industry model. These are men who brought us into the future, right? They tore down barriers. They were. But I think that like that's a narrative that you see, you know, that Standard Oil used that narrative, Andrew Mellon used that narrative. And Brandeis, there's a great book that you can just download called Other People's Money, The Bankers and How They Used It, which shows that the engineers and the people that build the technology are not the same people who are usually the financiers who capture that technology and then concentrate power over it. So in fact, the narrative that I subscribe to, and this is that in many ways, these companies they're not bringing us into the future. They're actually slowing down innovation. So one of the great antitrust suits was a suit against AT&T in the 1950s that said that AT&T could no longer, had to release its patents and anybody could license those patents. It had to teach other companies how to use those patents if they wanted to, and it was not allowed to go outside the phone business. One of the patents was for something called the electronic transistor, and they taught a small company called Motorola and another one called Texas Instruments how to build these, and out of this came the entire electronics industry and eventually Silicon Valley. And Silicon Valley was a whole bunch of small companies that were competing, and the antitrust suit against IBM in the 1970s, and antitrust suits against RCA and one against Microsoft oxygenated the markets and allowed small groups of people running companies to compete and innovate. And as bankers capture them, and that happens, it doesn't have to happen, but it with the right public policy framework, it does happen, then they spend a lot of money on PR to explain how they, in fact, brought us the future. But that is not actually true. U.S. Steel was not the great men of steel who built this. It was the great men of J.P. Morgan that did it, and they were kicked the engineers out of the room, right? So Boeing is a great roll-up of power, and they kicked the engineers out of the aerospace company, and that's why the planes are crashing. Facebook's a shitty product because Mark Zuckerberg monopolize the industry, and so he doesn't have to compete. And so they spend all their time trying to innovate around getting more ad revenue and innovating around tax shelters. So the things are getting worse. Like Google is a worse product today than it used to be, because what they're trying to do, where they put their engineering talent, is in sticking more ads into Google search. That's how their revenue goes up 20% a year. So the narrative of the great captains of industry is one that I think I would take issue with, and I think a lot of people believe it, but it's just not one that I subscribe to.
Facebook's not as shitty as you might actually think.
I'm just saying you're the one who said it.
It's not even that I like them very much. In fact, like, I don't like the product very much, and nobody that I know likes it. But that they would try and compete, say, with Google, and you might. So you're comparing the two like massive monopoly giants. And Google tried to do their social media and couldn't. And it's not like other people don't try, and that there's not like a hunger for anything other than Facebook. There's plenty of people that try. And many people, masses of people flow over to a new platform, and it just doesn't perform. And the thing with, we don't have electricity if you don't have J.P. Morgan backing, Edison. And you just don't, like, you don't have gasoline, you don't have cars, you don't have any of this stuff without a few people. And
that's, not, that's
every
just
time,
not true. I mean, that's just not true.
30 years before that, 30 years before that, people are just driving around in carts and horses. There's just nothing going on.
Okay, we had the development of the personal computer industry, or the computer industry in the 1950s and 60s and 70s, that was a pretty decentralized industry. You did not see the creation of robber barons because we had a public policy framework that said, it was, a lot of it was funded by the government. The public policy framework said, and this was Leon Kieserling in the Truman administration, said the innovations of the future will not belong, are gonna belong to the public, or they're gonna belong to the private monopolist. And so we had an industry that was structured in one particular way. And then in 1976 and 1980, we decided we would allow the copywriting of software. And 1982, we would basically stop enforcing antitrust. And so what happened? You saw the roll-up of massive amounts of power in the hands of Microsoft. Bill Gates then destroyed a bunch of his competitors using anti-competitive tactics. He did not bring us into the future. He just structured the future in a specific way that was good for him and served his interests and probably slowed technical development. And that's what you're seeing in Silicon Valley today, the dramatic slowing of technical development. Facebook uses a host of anti-competitive tactics. I don't have to prove this to you. The documents keep getting leaked showing that they did that. These guys are not competing based on innovating and making better things. These guys are competing using anti-competitive tactics and withholding capital. JP Morgan gained power over Westinghouse and General Electric during a financial crisis. He didn't do it by creating a better light bulb. If the light bulb had been invented and the electric utilities had been invented in the 1950s, we would have seen a very different deployment of that technology. In fact, in the 1930s, we did see a very different deployment of that technology. That's when the government did rural electrification. So the choice of how to deploy these technologies, the financing choices, are always a question of political, they're political choices. They're not about whether one person's just not that important. And a banker just isn't the guy that's making this stuff happen. It's the people laying cables, it's the people that are tinkering. That's who's actually creating this stuff. But I know, I take your point, sure. And they definitely...
It's the one person that's able to consolidate those forces.
Right, they're able... They're,
you have all
right.
The small businesses competing against each other, nothing really moves.
Right, forward. Napoleon conquered France. Napoleon ran France and conquered a whole bunch of countries, but he didn't create France, right? It's kind of like that. These are empire builders. They're not creators, right? They're great at creating empires and sort of grabbing things, right?
Place Napoleon a little bit different than Mark Zuckerberg or Rockefeller. That is hiring people and it seems to me that like the whole push for behind what you're saying about like regulating things is really the gun of the government.
Let me just point out there are different ways to regulate. Regulated monopoly, that's what Teddy Roosevelt wanted. It's also a kind of weird getting to concentrated corporate tyranny type of levels. That's what fascism is. It's regulated monopoly, right? It's not, regulated monopoly doesn't always have to be fascism, but regulated monopoly is bad because you can't ultimately regulate very, very large institutions. This was what was wrong with the ACA. It's what was wrong with Dodd-Frank. Instead of just breaking up the banks and putting in simple rules, we put 1,000-page attempts at micromanaging everything, right? We should have just broken these guys up and broken their power, or just nationalized some of this stuff directly. But instead, we just concentrated power and put a few, and tried to put incredibly complex regulations that only the big guys can follow, and also that they then invert it all. So what I'm talking about is a regulation like a stop sign. A stop sign is a regulation. It says stop, right?
Progress.
What?
Stop progress, right?
No, it's just stop your car. Like, what kind of stop signs are you using? Like, a stop sign is a stop sign. It's simple, right? You don't have to make 1,000-page, super complicated, weird, kludgy rules. What I'm saying is not make... I'm saying, like, we're just so used to laws not being enforced on the powerful that when we hear regulation, we hear corruption. But that's not what regulation has to be.
But we can just look at the government and see what they are doing. You can look at student loan debt. This is the first thing you came in and asked. And it's what you said during your speech. That the very people that you're asking to regulate us, which is political, which is government, are the most corrupt.
No, they're not. We elect them.
We
elect them. We can change. So this is interesting. So this is like, this is such an important point, right? Because what you're hearing right now is a lack of faith in democracy. That's what you're saying, is democracy can't work. And I respect that view.
But I mean, you were saying that too. I'm sorry. You were saying the very thing that, like, our Democrats, our politicians, they're listening to us. And
notice that
when
he asked me who the perfect candidate is, I said it's up to us. We are the ones who matter here because it's our belief that matters. What's the number one objection to Medicare for All? And I'm not going to go into whether it's a good idea or not. I have complicated views about that. It's not that people don't deserve health care. It's not that we want healthcare executives to be making a lot of money while, you know, killing us or not. It's a belief that things are going to get worse no matter what, that we can't do it, right? That we can't have nice things. And where does that belief come from? Because clearly there are a lot of nice things in this world. We went to the moon. We did amazing things. We created Medicare, which seems to work. Well, my answer to that is we lost faith in our public institutions and we stopped allowing ourselves to believe that we could govern, wield power, and make mistakes or not. So we allow Mark Zuckerberg to move fast and break things, but we don't allow our own public servants to do that. And we are afraid. So if we can overcome that fear,
we can govern again.
Otherwise, we're going to be governed by Mark Zuckerberg. And we're going to be governed by Xi Jinping. And we're going to be, if you don't govern yourself, if you do not have liberty, if you do not seek to wield power over yourself and over your community and over your world, then other people are happy to do it for you. And that's just the choice. That's just the choice. There is no option three.
So I think I'd be a whole lot less afraid of Mark Zuckerberg, even though I don't like his politics, than I would of having the state actually run things. When you have China is a perfect example of how they use the technology that this regulation, what it seems to me is when I hear it talks about the regulation that and trying to understand what's going on with the algorithms with Facebook and Google is that they really want, I mean, all these phones that we have, they're listening devices, our little Amazon listening things. I mean, everything is just tracking us all over the place, and really that you would regulate, not you, but that
I'm tracking
of
all
course,
of you.
The attempt to regulate
really
is
weird.
Really
everyone
an
who
to
left
give, is an attempt to give the government that power. And so what? I'd actually prefer fine ads that you know are tracking me than have the government tracking. Not that I don't think they're doing it anyhow, but I really think that the push for that is really is the push to legitimize the government's eye on us.
Well, any other? Now we're just arguing. So anybody else want to get in this one? No, I mean it's great. I think it's important.
So I guess we're talking about how big businesses are capturing the power, but I guess at the same time we need to look at the government or politicians who are granting them the power. And like there is actually emerging field of public policy which is differentiated between rent seeking when you have big businesses going to the politicians as asking for favors like licenses, but at the same time you have rent extraction when you have politicians punishing and enforcing the law, but at the same time trying to get the political power at this point like money in order to finance their political campaigns. So you have like this, I guess, like speaks to a point that you have all these big businesses capturing the power, but at the same time it is the government which is granting them the power. So how are you gonna, what is the solution when it is your government and it is your democracy or it is your institutions who are granting them the power? How are you gonna enforce the law when you have politicians who are cooperating with the big businesses?
You got to change the philosophy of what voters expect. I mean, what I saw when Obama and Bush, you know, concentrated power in the hands of bankers and then in the hands of big tech, I saw a mass endorsement of that policy from Democrats. Right. So I saw Obama, when the gay rights community attacked him for not supporting gay marriage, he changed his behavior because people forced him to. I saw a real fear on the part of citizens to demand a government that stands up for them because it was their guy on TV and they didn't want to be upset with their guy. So I think that these political leaders are responding to our own fear and our own tolerance of deference to concentrated power. So if we change and we change our demands, then I think policymakers will change what they do. Because the hardest thing I've run into, and I think both of you have that sense of fear of the state, which is legit because the state is scary, but also a fear of the leaders that you elect, which is not reasonable. Because if you can elect them, it means you can also kick them out of power. There's just a fear that fellow citizens cannot make good decisions. And ultimately, we have to find a way to have fellow citizens making good decisions. And one of the things that I see that's very hopeful is someone like AOC or Katie Porter are really asking about political economy questions and making a good case for them and exposing. You do a lot of oversight. I think that's really great. I think a lot of what the government's supposed to do is educate. And I'm seeing a lot more education going on, and I really like that. And I think we need to do a lot more educating, a lot more exposing of how our markets and our industries and our government works. I understand there's a lot of fear. There's a belief that we can't change things, but we should be afraid of that instinct, because that instinct does mean that we are giving up our liberties, and we should recognize that that is a really bad choice to make. Even if the alternative is we may not win.
When you were talking about regulating sort of how data gets taken and stuff, I just sort of wanted to bring up, you know, you mentioned, I don't want Facebook having my data, but I don't want the government either. I mean, I guess in my mind, the government saying, hey, you're not allowed to take and record this data or use it in any way, isn't the same as handing the government that information that's different. But that doesn't really mean much in terms of, you know, how I feel about regulating data usage and stuff. I mean, I guess part of it is also that, like, Facebook and other social media things for most people aren't a necessary product, you know. So the role which the government needs to play in regulating that might be smaller than other industries, I guess. But, yeah. I thought it was worth mentioning.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. I mean, yeah.
I guess, like, my fear would be that we might be overestimating the power that people have, because once you're electing the government, basically you're losing the power over them immediately once you have elected the government. So it's like, it's pretty hard to say that you have that much power that you can decide what will happen after, even if you elect them. So I guess,
well, we have a fragmented political system. So every 2 years we elect members of the House of Representatives, and then and some members of the Senate, and then every 4 years you elect the president, and you have state. You know, there's about 500,000 elected positions in this country, and I don't think that, you know, in my experience dealing with elected officials, they are pretty responsive to people. They just didn't hear, like, they responded to what they heard. It's very hard to imagine that this is what people wanted, but it is what people wanted. And if you are afraid, if we as a society are afraid, they will respond to that fear. And they are responding to that fear. That's why you don't see them standing up for you. Because they know that if they stand up for you and are like, I am going to go fight that billionaire, that half the Democrats are going to be like, I want my politicians to get along with people. Right? They know that the voters, the Democratic primary voters, don't have their back. They're responding to voters. It's really upsetting to hear that. Most people don't want to believe that voters have these attitudes. And I'm not saying all voters do. Again, this is the boomers. It's not you guys. But it is true that is the way that and you guys are just disorganized. You don't know what's in your interests yet, right? And you're learning. So learn. That's like a lot of the key is education. I mean,
so I think one of the things that sits right on the surface about learning and what's obvious to most people is that these people that are the captains of industry, you might as well just call them out through time, they're actually doing such a good job that they're productive. There's if you want something sent overnight, I mean, this is the example that's always often used, is that a private company like FedEx does a far better job than the post office. The government runs a deficit and that is so horrible that the people, most of the people in this room, their grandchildren are going to be paying for the things that the government's spending today. So that's not the case with Facebook. That's not the case with these captains of industry. They're moving things. They're getting things done in a way. They're making jobs for millions of people. And that's just not what the government's doing. And that's why we don't have trust in them. They run up student debt, which, you know, and to one of your comments that you said earlier, that if government could run, I think it's what you said, something like that, if democracy could run as well as an autocracy, then it would do well. But it actually turns out, and I think that's what he was saying earlier about the focus on the large group, the large masses of people that kind of get influenced by celebrity culture, that there's a part of democracy that's just really unfunctional for government, but pretty functional for business.
So let me tell you about why government got ruined. So this is in the book. So this is something called the Reinventing Government Initiative in the 1990s. American government used to be amazing, right? We were really good at governing. And it seems weird, but you know, the anti-government sentiment is relatively new. And we went to the moon, right? That was a real thing. Building up the arsenal of democracy during World War II, that really happened. Building a highway system, like just a ton of stuff that was really great, but also it worked. A lot of Silicon Valley, like it worked. Like the stuff that we built, you know, sometimes it was really evil stuff. You know, using Agent Orange in Vietnam was a terrible thing to do, but the Agent Orange worked, right? It's like, that competence, that governing competence disappeared in the 1990s, and it was a series of public policy choices. That was under, there's a group of people under this woman named Elaine Carmack, she was now at the Harvard Kennedy School, and a series of others, but under Bill Clinton and Al Gore. What they did is they said, we're gonna change how government contracting works. First of all, and this was mostly the defense space, because in the defense where most of our spending goes through is the Pentagon. And the Pentagon is the largest buyer of stuff in the world. You just buy everything from pencils to nuclear missiles. And they're really good at buying things, or at least they were. They had tens of thousands of people whose expertise was in buying things and knowing how much things cost and knowing when they're getting ripped off and not. And it was corrupt. There was definitely some problems in the, you know, but there was a deal in the 1980s when Reagan got in, and I learned, this is not in the book, but I learned this later. There was a deal that Reagan was like, I want to increase defense spending dramatically. And the Democrats said, okay, we'll fund that, but we get to write the contracting rules. And there was some, they let a bunch of things go, but like there was, you know, Reagan spent a lot more money and defense contractors made a lot more money, but they didn't have much higher margins. They just built 12 ships instead of 8 ships. When Bill Clinton came in 1992, there was sort of this question as to whether he was going to go back to the traditional populist democratic tradition of attacking concentrated power. And he ran kind of a populist campaign, and there was a weird third party candidate named Ross Perot. And so what was he going to do? And what he did is he doubled down on the concentration of wealth and power, and all the guardrails came off. And one of the things they did is he went to these defense contractors and he said, so, not him, but some of his subordinates, okay, so we're gonna cut spending because of the Cold War. How can we make you happy? And they said, well, you know what? You can cut spending and we'll be happy, but you have to raise our margins, right? So make us more profitable. Even if we're only making 6 ships instead of 8 ships, if we make more on each individual ship, we'll be happy. So the way that they did that is they said, okay, you guys are all gonna merge. And there was something called the Last Supper, where there were a whole bunch of defense contractor CEOs, and William Perry, who was Bill Clinton's assistant secretary of defense, said, you guys are all gonna merge. And over the next couple of years, the Pentagon subsidized these mergers. And so you had 105, 106 contractors, known as prime contractors, shrank to 5. That's when Martin Marietta and Lockheed became Lockheed Martin. That's when Boeing bought McDonnell Douglas. It's just over and over and over you saw merger after merger after merger. And there were mass layoffs in the space. And even though defense spending came way down, the S&P index for defense stocks actually outperformed the broader index. This is crazy. in an era of just radically declining spending. And they got rid of what's, or they cut, radically cut what's called the Defense Logistics Agency, which is where these buyers spent their time. And all these people flooded out who were experts. And working for the government can be fun, right? Being like, it's a really personally rewarding thing to do, to try to serve justice, to try to serve the people. You have, it is honorable. People like doing it. And if they will take less money to do it, as long as they don't have to, like, as long as you can send your kids to college and get health care and get a pension, you'll do it, right? And what happened is in the 90s, they just got rid of a lot of these people. They all flooded into the defense contractors. And then they also changed contracting rules to allow more sole source monopolistic contracts. And now, to do anything in government, they put lots of really weird ethics requirements, so it takes forever to do anything. And it's so bad now that you guys remember when the Obamacare website didn't work in 2014? So the contractor, because they had to hire contractors, because God forbid the government actually just hires people as government employees to set up websites. That would be impossible, right? They hire contractors. The contractors behind that website had a party when it didn't go up, because they were like, this just means that we're going to get more money, right? It's totally crazy. And there's all these elements of corruption there. And that didn't used to happen. That was a result of public policy choices that we made. There was resistance to it. We could undo them. We know what the laws were. We can undo them. We can rebuild these bureaucracies. You could do things like, you could put cost accounting standards on defense contractors, which is one of the, which basically says you have to tell us what stuff costs. We can do this. This is not impossible. But we have to want to do it. We have to want to govern again. We have to have people that are interested in the institutional details. And that means, that's why it's so important that we have these renewed focus in academia, to focus on the institutional details of political economy and history. That's why we have new generations of people who are learning, like looking at economics from the lens of climate change. What are the institutional changes we're going to need to make to address climate change? How do you do accounting for these kinds of shifts? The nitty gritty, like cleaning this stuff up is going to take a ton of work, and it's going to be really fun. But the thing is we have to know that we can do it, and we have done it before. So the point here is, we can be cynical and skeptical, and there's a lot of reason for pessimism, and there's a lot of reason to look at the government and say they can't do anything. And you know what? They can't. It's true. And that's my main problem with Medicare for All. In 1967, if you did Medicare for All, it would work easy, no problem. The government was good at stuff. This government is shattered, and we have to rebuild it. Right? It's totally shattered, but we can rebuild it. That's the point, is that we've been here before. We know how to do this. This stuff is not inevitable, right? That's the point.
Yeah, so coming off of that, and I think my comment was what some Dan had asked you before about right-wing populism.
Right.
And I think that terminology automatically comes with the thought process of pretty loaded question, right? So I'm going to throw a name out there that may also be loaded, but like Steve Bannon, I think you mentioned that name, right?
Right.
I think the answer of what you're saying is the cooperation of left-leaning populism, where a right-leaning person might think of that as socialism, which doesn't have to be, and the cooperation of a left-leaning populist group with a right-leaning populist group, minus white nationalism and all that other stuff that sometimes tends to come with it, because that's obviously wrong. Those two groups together, I think, can work together to tear down the institution that none of us trust anymore, right, and that is broken. But that's my thought of how this gets fixed through what you've already said.
I totally agree with that. And I think Steve Bannon is a bad faith actor. But I don't think that everyone on the right that uses this language is a bad faith actor. And when I talk to, you know, especially like voters and stuff, like for whatever reason, Republicans are way more open to thinking about business. For some reason, a lot of business people like are into this kind of thing more than the left, which is weird. But yeah, I totally agree with you. And I think that, like, when I talk to, say, people who are upset about China, right, and the China story fits into this, because what happened is like a lot of private equity guys and monopolists came in and rolled up factories across the country and then sold them to China, right? So it was the monopoly and finance problem, that turned into a foreign policy problem. So I talked to a lot of these manufacturers, not a lot, it was three or four of them, being like, what happened? And they told me, and these are nationalists, like these are manufacturers. They're like, we can't make anything anymore, and this is a huge problem, and China can make everything, and they want to rebuild our industrial capacity. They want to build it here, and they don't want to pollute, but they're not on the left. They culturally, they're conservative. The thing is if you talk to like an AOC or a left-wing populist, they want localism. What does that mean? It means make it here. But just the culture is different, and the institutional links aren't there. But I do think, I mean, one of the best pieces of legislation on healthcare is by a Republican in Indiana named Jim Banks. And his bill says that in a hospital market, and hospitals are very concentrated now, I can go into it, but it doesn't really matter. Hospitals are driving up costs in these crazy ways. His bill says that in a market, if the hospitals are really concentrated, like if there's no competition in the market, then what you effectively have is private price setting. The hospital just chooses what everything costs, and they will just rip you off. So he says, well, I'm just going to say, if it's so concentrated that they can do that, they have to accept prices that the government sets through Medicare. Government sets a bunch of prices through Medicare, and they just have to accept Medicare prices for everything they sell. If they're not concentrated, then it's a competitive market, and then they can compete over prices. And that would basically drop healthcare costs for an average family of four by something like $5,000 to $10,000 a year, right? And that's a right-wing approach, right? It's also an approach that I like, but because what he's saying is, if you have private government in this market, aka private price setting by an unregulated monopolist, we are just going to do public price setting. We're going to price administer through the government. And the way around that is you can just break yourself up and you can compete, and then price becomes, you get price discovery through people bargaining with each other without overwhelming amounts of bargaining power. And I think that that's the kind of, you know, depending on what happens in this election, I think we might need to do that. I think it's going to have to come through. Like in the 1930s, it was like basically there just weren't Republicans. That's what happened. There were 80 or 77, 78 Democratic senators. There were like 10 Republicans. It just weren't Republicans. So the fights were in the Democratic Party. That's not how it necessarily has to be. It's not how it's always been. You can build, and also the Democrats had a lot of right-wing people we would consider right-wing populists. And there's a lot of freighted things that go along with that. But you can build out that coalition. I think it's waiting to be built.
My question is that industries, and I don't literally mean manufacturing industries, or I mean whole sectors of the economy, sometimes they have a tendency to monopolize just because it's more profitable or more efficient for the particular company to monopolize. So, you know, take the healthcare industry, for example. You have multiple hospitals getting together, HMOs being formed, et cetera, et cetera. How do you prevent those monopolies from forming without impacting, you know, business and innovation and that whole sector and, you know, moving the economy forward as a whole?
So typically when you see more concentration of power, so there's two ways to understand concentration. There's sometimes someone is just better at something, and so they just take more share in the market. And that would be like the good kind of concentration. I produce a better product, so I sell more of my product than other people in the market. Then there's the other kind of concentration in which you just have power and you use that power to undermine competitors and bargain down suppliers. And that usually undermines efficiency. And I think that what you have to do is make distinctions when you're looking at markets and between those two kinds of concentration. And what I think the public policy framework, you've seen in previous eras in American history, much less concentrated market sectors, which were driven by different public policy frameworks. So I think you have to like look at our current public policy framework and see that it enables a whole host of anti-competitive behavior that actually hinders productive capacity and efficiency. And you see that in the productivity statistics, which are really bad right now. So despite all the arguments, oh, the robots are taking everything, productivity is not going up. It's actually going down a little bit. And that's because monopolists are not more efficient, they're less efficient. Because they only deploy technology when they have to, and when it's good for them, versus when there's actually competition, they have to deploy new technology and innovate to stay ahead. So the spur to innovation and productivity increases is actually competition, not monopoly in general. But you do have to make that distinction between concentration that happens because people are just making better products and concentration that happens purely for financial reasons. The reason I think it's mostly happening now for financial reasons is because the financial sector is so massive, and large financial sectors don't exist unless they're just manipulating power and kind of looting corporations, which is what's happening, which you see all over the economy.
Tyler Cowen, big business.
Is there anything you could say about him that hasn't been covered substantively?
I mean, he's just part of that, the law and economics movement, right? The libertarians that came out of the 1950s, he's part of that tradition, which is to say that he wants to take the restraints off of concentrated capital. He buys into the narratives of, there's only good concentration. He buys into the captain of industry narrative. He just has an ideological framework that is driven by a belief that public institutions should stay out of the way and allow private financiers to sort of organize our society. That's how to produce a good society. He's also funded by a bunch of them, which is not, I'm not saying he doesn't believe it, but he also has strong incentives to believe it.
Well, let's thank Matt Stoller.
Thank you.